please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Hello and welcome to this special episode of Market Masters. Our guest today is someone we all know, and of course, over the last many years, he has had distinct views on the market. He has been a big bull at times, he has been a big bear at times. Right now, of course, he remains a big bull. Our guest today is Shankar Sharma of First Global. It's been a rough year for the markets. If you look at the MSCI Asia X Japan, from the highs, it's down quite a bit. But what's interesting is that we have underperformed quite a bit, Shankar. What do you think is going wrong with the Indian market in 2018?
Well, actually, it's nothing to do with 2018. The problem started I would say the seeds of the problem were sown in the early part of 2016, which is when the commodity cycle bottomed out. I've been publicly bullish on oil and other metals and, you know, generally the commodity complex since February, March of 2016. And that is where problems for India started. Of course, a lot of problems build up over time. They happen on stealth. But really, India got the dividend of a sharp fall in oil for the 2 or 2.5 years preceding that. And that dividend slowly started to get eroded from the lows of oil at $27 or $30. So the underperformance you're seeing now was actually building up. It's not like sudden, and I was of the view that the same oil dividend which gave us a lot of pleasure will give us a lot of pain when it reverses, and it has reversed incrementally. I think India is the most, if you talk, let's say, just broad macro. Indian micro is still very good, which I will come to later, but Indian macro amongst emerging markets, or let's say the BRIC pack, appears to be the most worrisome, largely because of oil, because our macros turned for the better only because of oil, because structurally India was still the same. I mean, there was nothing really structurally that changed much, but just that oil came down, so inflation came down, rates came down, household savings started to get channeled in the stock markets, equities became more attractive versus fixed income, etc., etc. We all know that story. That story, to some extent, has been dented because of the rise in oil, the rise in bond yields, the rise in inflation, imposition of the capital gains tax. So the point you're making was in the building, and it has been only accentuated by the recent moves in the budget, but it's not something that is surprising, at least not to me.
Okay, so Shankar, how much of a factor has the LTCG been, the long-term capital gains tax? We've seen a lot of aggressive selling by FIIs, but that was the case all through last year as well, and the Indian market was still going up. So a lot of people are asking has that imposition of LTCG changed sentiment a bit? Is that largely responsible for the underperformance of Indian market for the last 2 or 3 months?
No, I do not think it is solely responsible for the underperformance. I think it has contributed, but I wouldn't say that is the large part of the problem. It is a smallish part of the problem. My view on LTCG has been very simple, that yes, there was a case to impose a tax on equity gains. Question was when. India still, I mean, you don't have to view it as a revenue generation measure. You have to view it that you need people to move away from gold and real estate and even fixed income into a riskier asset class such as equities, which is the way the world has, let's say, the developed markets have moved, where people don't own real estate much, or they don't own fixed income or gold, and it's largely household wealth is concentrated in equity markets. So if we want to mirror that global trend of moving into riskier capital, then you have to incentivize that move. So the long-term capital gains tax was an incentive, the exemption of that was an incentive for people to move away from fixed income and other unorganized forms of saving into an organized form of saving, which would fuel growth, companies can raise money, etc., etc., etc. You cannot look at it just as a revenue generation exercise. And India is still under-owned in terms of household wealth and equities. So yes, there was a case. Question is when. My view was maybe 10 years later, when maybe 30-40% of savings are in equity markets. Globally, it's, you know, developed countries are like 50%, 70%, 80%. We don't have to wait that long. But when you're, you know, wherever we are right now, you have to give incentive. It's like giving incentive to an industry. You have to give incentive to backward area, industries. You have to give incentives to pharma. You have to give incentive to telecom. You have to give incentives to software. View it as an incentive being given and to a very nascent industry, which is equity investing. I just view it from that lens. From that lens, there was no justification to do it now, but there was justification to do it at some point in the future, but that's a long way down the road. So yes, it has affected sentiment, but I don't think the underperformance is because of that. I think the underperformance is because of the fact that, I think two major factors, and I think the overarching one is obviously oil. Mm-hmm. I think my view on oil is very bullish. It has been very bullish for the last year and a half. So I don't want to sound alarmist from an Indian perspective, but I wouldn't be surprised if oil goes up another 20, 30, 40% from here over the course of the next month or year. That will be problematic for India. And that is the one of the reasons why the market is behaving the way it is. So the market is reading the tea leaves that the macro for India over the next 12 months will be, let's say, more worrisome than the macros are for Brazil or Russia or China. Brazil and Russia are obviously big beneficiaries of the up move in commodities. So, they have done phenomenally well in terms of stock prices. Brazil in the last couple of years in dollar terms has almost, I think, doubled. I mean, I think maybe 80% up. Russia is doing very well. India that way has been a little tepid performer if you look at the Nifty. I mean, over the last 4 years, I think it's about 12.5% return, which is, you know, not worth writing home about in context of an overall global equity bull market.
Sure.
It's only the small caps which have gone up 45% compounded in the last 4 years, which changed the picture for Indian equity returns completely. Otherwise, just looking at that Nifty, it's nothing worth writing home about the last 3-4 years.
But coming back to the markets, give and take everything, it's not even a 10% correction from the top. So what's your view for the rest of the year? Do you think that this is still a correction in an ongoing bull market, or have we started to see the beginning of a bear phase in Indian equities?
No. I don't think there is any bear market in Indian equities,
okay.
Nor is there a bear market in global equities. We kind of forget that markets don't have to just keep going up perennially or even for 6 or 8 months. We will have sharp cutbacks. And it's just one of those things. I mean, there is nowhere in the market globally, in markets globally, that I see a bubble or I see irrational valuations. I mean, S&P is like 15, 17 times earnings forward. Bear markets don't start when you're looking at those kinds of valuations. So if there is no bear market in emerging markets, there's no bear market in the developed markets, why should India stand out? In my view, the Nifty and the Sensex will underperform global markets. The small cap will vastly outperform the global market. So there are two different markets in India. And just looking at equity returns the last 4 years, it's very apparent. 12% versus 45% compounded. That kind of return diversion has never happened in the history of India. And I've been publicly very bullish for the last 4 years on small caps. And that's been the reason that I've been worried about the macro, but not worried about the micro. So India will not have a bear market. There's no bear market globally. There's no bear market in India. India might lag on the large cap basis relative to emerging or relative to sort of developed markets. But there's no bear market.
I also wanted your view on politics because, you know, it's the biggest talking point now. Is the Modi government losing a bit of its magic? I mean, we're seeing major farmer agitations now. And, you know, this was the big government's key agenda, right? Solving the agrarian crisis. Do you think the 2019 elections are going to be much different from what we saw in 2014? Or is it too premature to view that?
I mean, my view is that, you know, the magic, etc., to be used for politics is misplaced. I mean, I don't believe that politicians can create magic. So, you know, when people have such huge expectations, which are irrational, disappointment is inevitable. And I've said this at the beginning of the election cycle in 2014, that you're betting, it's just a way out bet, which can only end in disappointment. So whatever you are saying right now, I mean, I'm not surprised at that. It's just like a management coming out and you believe blindly in that without analysis. So you will have, some degree of disappointment. Even though they have tried well, they have done whatever they were supposed to do to some extent, you will still come away saying, hey, you know, it could have been better. So I don't pay much attention to, you know, all these sentiments around politics of India, for that matter, rest of the world. But yes, 2019 will be interesting. I mean, obviously, the kind of numbers you saw in 2014, it was like, absolute, dream run for the ruling coalition. It does appear that it may not be that smooth, and that will play on the market. I mean, that we know. I mean, from a limited lens of stock markets, one can assume that 2019 may be a little bit more problematic than 2014 was. Mm-hmm. So yes, that's one of the other factors that will build up as a concern on our stock markets as the year progresses. The other thing, of course, is we don't even know whether it's 2019 or even 2018, as the buzz that we hear is it could probably happen this year itself. So, those things are fairly near term. I mean, a year is not that long a time, or even 6 months, not that long a time. So the market is kind of a little worried about that aspect as well.
You have been on record saying Indian small caps is the best asset class in the world. So right now, there's no danger to that thesis because we have seen a sharper mid-cap and small-cap correction. And the fear is that it may impact equity inflows, especially from the mutual funds and from the domestic households.
Anuj, I've spent the last month or so speaking to various companies we are interested in, we have interest in. Almost across the board, FY19 numbers look absolutely in the bag for practically all of them. Where you're looking at earnings growth of 30%, 50%, even 150%, and that makes the valuations not very demanding. Now, my learning in markets is only this, that when you have market corrections like the kind that we have seen, and I've lived through in my 25, 30 years, God knows, 200 of such things. When a move like this happens, you just need to go back again to fundamentals, remove technicals for a minute, come back to fundamentals. Stock prices are down 30% or 40%, 35%. If balance sheets are in good shape and if the earnings number are still intact, then they represent no-brainer buying opportunities. I mean, that's been my central learning. So, and that's a very simplified learning, but it has really worked over the years. So, I mean, all the companies that I've spoken to, stock prices are down 30%, numbers look intact, balance sheets are in good shape. I mean, I think it's a no-brainer to go out and buy those companies without any doubt at all. And I'm sure, my universe is not as large as many people's universe. I'm sure the same story is there in dozens and dozens of small cap companies where, they're all doing very well. They're unaffected by the worsening macros of India. And that's one of the reasons why I like small caps, apart from their micros. That the macros don't affect the small caps. I mean, interest rate rise or inflation rise, they will affect the big ones, the big players like Larsen or like the banks, etc. But a small company doing some small business, small part of India, they are really unaffected by all this. So, I mean, my view is this correction for the companies that have their earnings growth intact, it's a no-brainer opportunity by way of buying.
Okay. Some of the PSU banks have also become mid and small caps, Shankar. How do you approach them? You just write them off, say, okay, I'm not looking at them? Or is there an opportunity in this whole mess?
There could be, but I'm not a big fan of banking or, businesses which require giving credit to people and then you go chasing after them to return, get your monies returned to you. I mean, I think there are easier ways to make money in life than to do this. So, NBFC or banking, etc. There are a few exceptions here and there, like IndusInd or HDFC Bank, which we have liked. But broadly as a category, my view is that I buy peace of mind apart from buying equity. And there's easier ways to make money. So, PSU banks are problematic. We all know that. But the real problem, in my view, is happening post the Nirav Modi scam. That there is, and I've spoken to bankers, spoken to companies, It's a weird situation wherein we don't have credit growth. Companies on the one hand are scared to expand. Banks on the other hand are scared to lend. And this whole turning the screws on every loan above 50 crores to be scrutinized by some investigative agency, etc. I mean, government might have some logic for doing that, but my view is only that the behavior of bankers will then turn contrary to what you really want to do, which is that you have to encourage some degree of risk-taking to rekindle the animal spirits in India. Because the animal spirits have gone dormant for the last several years. If you want to rekindle them, you have to inject a bit of risk. I'm not saying blind risk or unbridled risk, but without risk, there cannot be any any capex. Which promoter? I mean, I'm a businessman. I invest in companies. I run companies. I can tell you there is risk in every single move I do. And there are moves that I look back upon and say, why on earth did you do that? That's not because I am a scamster or I am corrupt. It could be simple business decisions gone wrong. When you create a fear of psychosis, you will cut back on lending, and that's precisely the wrong medicine for this patient. The other problem, of course, as I've just recently learned, is that it's not only a company, you're a good company, but if your bank is in trouble, okay, that's under the PCA, the prompt corrective action, then you will not get credit because your banker is in a problem, even though you are in the pink of health. So imagine that a company has now got to do a credit check on the bank, and the bank has to do a credit check on the company. I mean, this situation is completely absurd. If you were to tell this to somebody in the US, they would say, I mean, are you guys serious? I mean, it's just a bizarre situation. I think we just need to step back, take a deep breath and say, look, problems happen in finance, problems happen in banking, in Barings and Nick Leeson lost $1 billion, sank a bank, subprime scam happened. Nobody broke the system, nobody created a fear psychosis. Business went on. We need to really, you know, back off a little bit here and allow business to function. I know companies who are saying that for the big road projects, financing is not going to come forward incrementally, at least not for a while. I mean, imagine you want an aggressive road program and banks are scared to lend to roads. What kind of is that the situation you really want out of this? I think we need to lighten up a bit here. We need to accept that scams will happen in banking. They have happened across ages in the world. It'll happen in India too. But let's not throw the baby out with the bathwater.
A lot of stocks have corrected 30%, a lot of good quality balance sheets, you know, cases in point, names from the auto space, cases in point, domestic stories, etc. Where do you hunt for value now?
No, I mean, I think the metals pack, steel looks terrific. I mean, I've been bullish on all steel companies the last year and a half, along with, you know, my bullishness on commodities. They've corrected now, you know, because of the market and because of, you know, the tariff sort of, et cetera, being imposed by the U.S. But I don't think, you know, that really matters. I think they will go back. Steel prices will be firm across the world, and Indian companies will benefit. So that looks good. Construction companies look good. I mean, I've not liked this sector for a long time, at least in the 2004 to 2007 bull market towards the end. I thought it was completely irrational in terms of bidding. Too much competition, 30 players for a single road project. Now, it's a little bit of pricing sanity. Number of players has shrunk. So I like the road sector. The government's program on roads is reasonably aggressive, at least on paper. Even if part of it materializes, you're looking at very, very solid order books, you know, for these companies. Quality of tenders has improved in infrastructure overall. So overall, that space looks good. There are good players in that. You know, large players like Larsen, I think, will do very well, apart from the smaller ones in the overall roads and infrastructure sector. So overall, the space looks, the construction space, infra space, road space, broadly, I like that. I like metals. And interesting, those are the two sectors I did not like in the previous bull market. So you have to remain flexible.
Oh, yes. Shankar, you know, one call which worked out for you beautifully, I remember when I did that Unplugged show with you, you said the Indian IT will go through some serious problem. And we did see a big derating of Indian IT for 2 years. But has something changed over the last 6 months? Sure. Are you noticing some change? Or is this just a case of market moving to, you know, the valuation gap being just too high and the market correcting that?
No, look, the business model hasn't changed, and I don't think the business model is really being reshaped that fast. And in Infosys's case, there was a chance because of Vishal Sikka being there. At least, let's put it this way, at least he had the right words, you know, of all these machine learning and artificial intelligence and all these things, which itself, you know, has some value in today's world. If you mention that, you get some value from investors. I think Indian IT needs to remake itself. Over the last few months, some sanity in terms of stock price and, you know, a little bit of performance has come in. But I think it's too early to say whether it's back into a bull market mode. I mean, I would really reserve my you know, comments on that. I haven't thought it through completely whether, you know, it has been remade enough for it to deserve a big bull market. I do not have a clear view on that.
With proper disclosure, any, say, two or three stocks that Shankar Sharma is, you know, betting on for this year, 2018, or for 3 or 4 years?
Well, I've told you small caps, I've told you roads. I mean, I think that's enough hint that there are not that many players in the road space in small caps, and you know, with reasonable sort of balance sheets. And then on the small cap side, some of it is known, some of it is unknown, but I can tell you that space is still buzzing. I mean, I still have great number of opportunities staring me, you know, and you're really spoiled for choice there. So I just think, you know, this correction presents a great opportunity. If you're a small investor, don't buy the stocks. You can buy good small cap funds. There are plenty of them out there. If you're a professional investor, I think you should welcome an opportunity like this.
Okay, so just before we wrap up the show, Shankar, a month back you had tweeted that, you know, this is not a repeat of 2008. This is just a correction in an overbought market. Despite all that's happened over the last 1 month, the scams, the frauds, you still stick to that view?
Oh, 100%, without any doubt. And I'll go out to the extent of saying that you're going to see a huge bull market in emerging markets. It's just the beginning of a resurgence of a bull market. If you go back in time, bull market EMs have been actually trailing the global markets from 2010 onwards. I think that trend is reversing, and I think that's because of the commodity bull market and the weakness in the dollar. These two factors will drive emerging markets significantly higher. And one more thing before I go, if you look at the dollar index of emerging markets, it's still, I think, 10 or 15% away from 2007 highs. So you've not even taken out the highs in dollar terms of emerging markets, what we saw in 2007. In my mind, a bull market starts when you cleared out long-term highs, which happened 5 or 10 years back, and then a new bull market is born. So it's still not even a bull market in EMs. A bull market will start when they cleared out 2007 highs in dollar terms. So I think there is a big, big journey ahead in terms of bull market in EMs, without any doubt.
Okay, on that very optimistic note, Shankar Sharma, thank you so much for joining us.
Sure.